Hello. Well, today I wanted to talk about being a cutting-edge playwright. I went to the University of Utah and majored in theater. And my head of my department was a famous Shakespearean director who brought in people from New York, Hollywood, actors to do Shakespeare at the University of Utah, because Utah people love Shakespeare. And then he also brought them to do other plays, like George Bernard Shaw was one when I was there. And so, after I had read a lot of plays, I aspired, because of my background, to be a cutting-edge playwright. In fact, I thought there was no other kind of playwright that I could be, because my life, even from a little girl, was lived in controversy, in a situation that I had not been able to talk about at the university. I wanted to talk about it, but what made it so difficult is because I was in theater. And what made it necessary to talk about was because in theater, there was more apt to be gay students. But of course, in those days, everybody kept very quiet about that subject. It was not talked about. So when I tried to write more in-depth papers that I could possibly talk to this brilliant Shakespearean director, he would just ignore them. In fact, he called me in one day when I was a sophomore when I wrote one of these and said, "I can't accept this." And I thought, "What?" And I challenged him. I said, I more or less said that I wasn't going to write another one. So if he wanted to fail me, he could right there. And he didn't fail me. But he shook me up. And I thought, oh, I'm disappointed. I did not expect a director of his caliber to be trying to shut a student up before she even opened her mouth. But he must have sensed that what I wanted to tell him was too difficult for him to. His health was starting to fail. They were even talking that he might have to retire. He had ulcers and he had an awful big program of plays going on. And when I was a freshman, I got a big part, a leading part in one of the plays that he was taking on the road. It was a very charming, wonderful children's play called The Great Ant Sits on the Floor. And he cast me as the great ant, probably because my facial features and I could play an older woman. I wasn't too happy about playing an older woman, but in part was fantastic. So anyway, I thought, oh, what am I going to do? You see, the secret that I wanted to tell him was that my dad was gay, but he was living as a married man and supposedly hiding. And was trying to get help. I was still trying to get help because he naturally had quite a number of partners that I suspected of him being involved with that were like hired men that he would go camping with for days and would be out riding with, working with, and so I saw kind of how he operated. But anyway, he managed to make one of these hired men that I had already detected he was having an affair with, because the man called my attention to it, and I was only like 5. And I got it, but I felt like I'd been hit with a rock. And then my dad went off to drink and party, and this man molested me out of revenge. He was angry, jealous. So at a very early age, I was privy to a relationship that I struggled with. I couldn't see that my mother, she may have suspected, she knew him very well, she wouldn't hesitate to criticize him, tell him what was what, but she did not seem to get what I was seeing. And I didn't feel like I should be the one to tell her. It might be very dangerous, because they fought a lot, and I just felt that they could have a terrible fight over this. So I just kept thinking about it, well, what can I do about this? So when I got to the University of Utah, I thought, well, and I even went to visit the school psychiatrist, but I wasn't to the point that I could ever told him that, the university psychiatrist. But I mentioned that I had had what was thought to be a nervous breakdown when I was about 13, or before I went away to school, and that was why I was sent away to school, because of this episode. So I knew that I still had the problem. I hadn't been able to talk to anybody about this. And I hoped that I would be able to the Shakespearean director would be able to handle a little tiny bit of it. But he couldn't. He just, and I'm sure he did it because he wasn't well. This didn't sound to him like anything he wanted to deal with. So I thought, oh dear. And 2 more years went by, and I thought, I'm not going to get any help here. But I need help to surface this burden that I'm carrying. I can't be carrying this burden secretly forever. I'm going to have to somehow or another try to get this. Well, I tried in all my classes. And nobody seemed to get that. And so I thought, well, I don't care anymore. I'm going to have to leave the university. They're not helping me. It's the same old thing. They're not here. They're supposed to be a great university. They're not even dealing with reality, with my reality. And it's important because it's the gay issue. And theater, New York theater, that's where the cutting edge gay theater was going on. And I looked at my Shakespearean director, head of my department, and I thought, he's got a wife and kids. Well, his wife played a role in one of the plays. He cast her. It was like she expected. She played a Shakespearean role. And then she played another big role that I by that time, I was vying for it too. But of course, I didn't get it. she got it, and she was wasn't even on campus. She was just, you know, treated like a member of the theater troupe. And he took no interest whatsoever in her, even though she had a huge part. She just learned the lines, said them however she wanted to. And he was working with a very talented young comic, but he just, and I thought to myself. And then there had come along a returned missionary who had, I figure, gay issues. And he had left his mission, so he got all the parts, and they were doing those kind of parts. And then I'd also encountered another professor that the head of the department had brought in, and he was a mean one. And they said that he'd married, and his wife had been in a psych ward for 2 years, and he was mean. So I thought, oh, it's all over the place. Cover wives. And that society, the men don't have to come out. They can just, they're encouraged to get married, have children. And if they don't quit their gay activities, where the wife is just supposed to look the other way, she's not even supposed to see it. And this professor, head of the department, he's not going to let me tell him anything. He probably suspects what I want to tell him, and he's not going to let me. So why stay here? They haven't come up to the challenge of honesty about this subject. And oh, I'm just working myself up to. And then my professor did say to me, I had done everything, trying to get to the other teachers. Well, he said, and I was actually in a play on the road. He had cast me as a secondary lead. I was playing a young Amish girl, very innocent and pure and sweet. She's just the opposite of what I didn't aspire to be. Innocent, meek, you know. Because my dad didn't have any boys, so I had done voice work. I had cow-punched. I had done everything that I kind of worked that I could do, was capable of doing, and so had my sisters. So I just, well, I thought, he's trying to tell me the kind of girl that I should be, and I'm not going to be that, and I don't believe in being that, because I'm going to find somebody to talk to about this. If I have to leave this university to do it, I'm just wasting my time here, and he needs to know it. So he said, well, won't you please just go to the school psychiatrist university before you leave. So he called him up and made an appointment for me. I don't know what he told him, but I went in there, and I've been doing this even too. I would even, if they kept coming at me with a conventional, you know, business as usual, I would break in with a moment of silence, like protesting. So when this professor started asking me questions, I thought, well, I'm leaving the university. This is the last time I'm ever going to be in this office, so I'll give him a little. So he asked me 3 questions. I looked him right in the eye like this, defiant. Didn't answer. 3. Took all the nerve I had. 3 questions was all I had in me to ignore. I thought, well, he needs to know that I'm disturbed, even though I'm going to have to leave. So he left the room, and I thought, oh dear, I didn't get through to him either. He's just ignoring me like all the rest. It's hopeless. Well, should I just leave? And finally, I was just about to get up and walk out of there forever, and here come the psychiatrist back. And he walked in the room and said, "Geraldine, I think you need to go into a hospital." "What?" Well, the first thing I said was, "I am in a play. I'm on the road. I need to go. Because you never let down a play. You don't do that. And I needed to go on the road and perform that part." He said, "You are going into the hospital." Now he's laying down the law. And then he summoned a man who looked like a cop. He had a gun strapped to his side. I'll do therapy. No. The man took me in charge like I was being arrested. And I thought, oh my God, I didn't know that I could be arrested and taken off to, the psych ward for not answering 3 questions. Oh, I should have known. And so that started it, my stay in the psych ward that was run by the University of Utah Medical School in the county hospital on 21st South. That's where we went. And I was incarcerated, and that was the first time I found out that just being incarcerated, committed to a psych ward, automatically got for me a prescription of shock treatment. And so the next thing I learned was that I would have a series of shock treatment right off the bat. Well, I had chronic fatigue since I was 10 years old, the first time I had a bout. And I'd had some really bad problem with it. So the first thing I thought was I shouldn't have electric shock therapy. So I said, "But I can't have it. There's something wrong with me." They said, "You don't have a choice. You don't have a choice," they said. I didn't have a choice. And even if I thought it would be very bad for me, I couldn't turn it down. No. I am now judged insane enough based on what I did that I am going to have shock treatment against my will entirely. Yes, that's it. That upset me very, very bad because, as far as I was concerned, it was life-threatening. They had no idea whether I could survive shock treatment. I didn't think I could. I'd had near-death experience over nothing, hardly. Surgery to get out my tonsils. I went into shock, nearly died. The doctor told my mother he didn't know my nerves were so bad, or he would not have done it the way he did. Bad nerves. Yeah, I had bad nerves, all right. And here they were, scheduling me for a series of electric shock treatments. If one didn't kill me, then maybe the rest of them, one of them might. And I couldn't say no. Oh, wow. Well, I've talked about this in a number of places. in my memoir, my first published memoir, what I did. And my second one is coming up, and I talk about it again, of how I had tried to figure out how to get them to pass on shock treatment. And I went around, talked to all of them, and found out every one of them was getting it. It was universal. And if they didn't get it there, they were going to be transferred to the state mental, and there they would get it. There was no escape from it. Not easy. Well, the first thing that I had to do, as I looked at it, in order to survive, make sure I survived, was get out of shock treatment. Whatever it took, I was going to have to do it. I requested an interview with the head psychiatrist who was in charge of my case. He was the head of the department in the medical school. I told him why I shouldn't have it, about experiences I'd had, and he didn't say anything. So I went to even more drastic measures to make sure they did not come upon me, as I saw them do with the only others, take them before they could say a word and give them shock to me, because none of the patients liked it. So I could, and I saw them when they came out, and it looked pretty brutal to me. Pretty brutal. And I'd had what I considered a very stressful childhood, manifesting illnesses, reflecting it. So I could not risk having it without doing something. So I did what I'd never heard of anybody doing, but I thought that I could do it. I went on strike, and I figured out that if I didn't take a deeper breath, just kept my breathing as it was, this would be a strike, and I would maintain this until I was sure they would not give me shock treatment. So I didn't exactly know what it was going to involve when I started with it, but I figured out that this would cause me to manifest behavior that would convince them I would die if they gave me shock treatment. So this caused me to go semi-conscious right away. I didn't know what it would do, but that's what it did. And they come and drag me up to my room and station me, and I was no longer moving. I was just semi-conscious. I could hear everything they were saying, but it was like I was locked into this mode of behavior. And I didn't know how long it was going to take before I decided that it was enough to convince them. Well, it turned out to take 4 hours. And I do not believe that they could have gotten me out of this, or anybody could have done. I couldn't, once I locked into this and kept my breathing going like that. Well, I found out later that the head of the department told the intern, who is now in charge of my case, that I was having a catatonic seizure, which I didn't know that's what I was doing, that I was I had gone catatonic. But to me, I was desperately hunting for something that would convince them. So 4 hours later, this culminated in the kind of breathing that you have when you're stuffing. And it's called Chain-Stokes, something like that, breathing. And it caused volunteer sounds and then loud ones that brought them running. Then, while they were right there, I stopped breathing. But they had told the nurses and so on just to leave me alone. That's what the head of the department, the head of the, my psychiatrist, told them to do. So they left, and I had quit breathing. I thought, well, I'm going to die if I don't come out of this. So I'm pretty sure now that's going to convince them. So I came out of it, sat up. When they came back in, it had been 4 hours. They said, you want dinner? And I said, yes. So they brought me dinner. I ate some of it. But I could tell I'd been through a terrible ordeal, but I was still able to do that. And the nurses told me, well, we're going to call the intern, because he sat by your bed for 2 hours. He couldn't figure out what was going on. We're going to tell him, he wanted to know if there was any change. I didn't talk about it, but this was indeed such an ordeal that I didn't recover from the effects of it for a number of months, but it did stop them. Because they told me that if I signed this paper that said I volunteered to commit myself, I guess so they wouldn't be liable to a psych ward. I wasn't going to sign it, but the intern wanted me to sign it, so I did. I thought, well, okay, I'll sign it, even though it's not the truth. So they said they wanted me to stay 2 more weeks to make sure that I was okay. And that was responsible after the very severe thing that I had done to rebel against shock treatment. So they said, so anyway, that right there shows you how my life previous had helped turn me into a, well, cutting edge writer, you might say. Here I was at the university ready to talk to them about the gay issue. They wouldn't talk to me about the gay issue. That professor would not let me tell my story to him. And in fact, I didn't tell the doctor, the intern, about it, because he didn't seem too knowledgeable about the subject. But I did tell him I'd been molested, which he told my parents, and that was the first time they ever heard about it, or anybody heard about it. Molested when I was 5, in that psych ward, telling it for the first time. And when my parents came, I didn't know the intern was going to tell them that even. But I had finally got somebody to listen to that much of my story. And what it took to get them to listen to it. So, anyway, that started the finally telling the story, which I finally told in full-length form in a memoir. And I also told it in a play, Daughters of the Shadow Man. So you see, I lived it, a very controversial issue, because in those days, it was like women couldn't even talk about such an issue. They weren't supposed to, even if they were dealing with it, with a husband like my dad. Nobody was talking about it. It was just like, and to me, a cutting-edge playwright is one who, just that, they're going to write about what is barely being talked about. Their circumstances have put them into touch with that kind of issue. And I was always talented at writing, so I was in touch with a very difficult issue, and I started writing about it. And throughout my life, I wrote about this kind of issue. And that is very hard for people to receive. I am not easy for people to understand when I'm writing about an issue that many, even now, have not thought about, have not considered what would happen if they were in that situation. The situation my mother was, marrying a guy like this, him not telling her, of course, anything. And she didn't really pick it up, but I did. Why? Because I was victimized by one of his partners at a very young age. And there's nothing like being victimized that will tell you what's going on, the worst thing that's going on, that he was capable of doing. And I looked at my dad as part of it because he had brought that man on the property. And I was at his mercy when he went off somewhere. He put me in danger. My own dad did. By bringing this dangerous man that he was not only hiring to work for him, but he was having a relationship with him, which he should have known was extremely risky, not fair to his wife, or me. So there we had that issue, right there, of honesty in marriage, and what not being honest can do, how dangerous it can be, extremely dangerous. So, as far as I'm concerned, I'm a cutting-edge playwright because I was born to the situation that turned me into one. That was my destiny that I couldn't escape. And it's very, very hard for people to accept and encourage cutting edge theater. It's got that cutting edge. It's dangerous. It can upset people. It can cause them to have to face what maybe they've been running away from for years. Like my dad, who died before I could ever even talk about the subject to him, even though he was told by the intern that his hired man molested me at 5 years